Now I request our second and last speaker in this national webinar, Professor Shantanu Vishwas. I would like to introduce Professor Vishwas before delivering his lecture. Dr. Shantanu Vishwas is a professor of English at Jadavpur University and a psychoanalyst practicing in Kolkata. As a psychoanalyst, he belongs to the Lacanian tradition. He has been a member of the Lacan Circle of Australia since 2005. He has lectured on psychoanalysis at numerous institutions in India and abroad. He has written extensively on the theory and practice of psychoanalysis, as well as on the interdisciplinary field of literature and psychoanalysis. His essays have been published in prestigious journals like the International Journal of Psychoanalysis, that was founded by Ernest Jones and Sigmund Freud himself. He is a member of the advisory board of some of the leading journals of Lacanian psychoanalysis in France, England, USA, Australia, and Slovenia. So I request Professor Vishwas, please deliver your lecture. Thank you.
Thank you very much, coordinator. Am I audible? Amar kotha shona jacche?
Ekdom porishkar shunte paoa jacche.
Okay. Thank you. As you would know, I'm going to talk about Sigmund Freud's concept of the death drive, or Todestrieb in German, in its relation to mental health with appropriate illustrations. আমি ভাষা নিয়ে একটা ছোট্ট একটা ল্যাম্পার দিয়ে দিই
মাউথপিসটা একটু মুখের কাছাকাছি এলে আর একটু সুবিধা হবে আপনার যে মাউথপিসটা আছে হেডসেটের সেটা আর একটু মুখের কাছে এলে একটু সুবিধা হবে
এটার কোনো আলাদা করে মাউথপিসের সাথে যা আছে সেটাই আছে তো এখন কি একটু বেটার
হ্যাঁ অথবা আরেকটা করে দেখতে পারেন আপনার কম্পিউটারের ভলিউমটাকে বাড়িয়ে দিয়ে দেখতে পারেন তাতে হয়তো আর একটু জোরে আসবে
আমি বাড়িয়ে দিচ্ছি সেগুলো বাড়িয়ে দিচ্ছি Is this better?
আমরা শুনতে পাচ্ছি
এখন
নাও ইটস বেটার এখন বেটার এখন বেটার
ওকে ওকে থ্যাংক ইউ শুভাংশু এটা অন্যদের অসুবিধা হচ্ছে তুমি এটা ক্লিয়ার না করলে আমি জাস্ট ল্যাঙ্গুয়েজ নিয়ে একটা জিনিস ছোট্ট একটা ক্লারিফিকেশন আই ওয়াজ ইন অ্যাওয়ার যে এখানে বাংলায় বলা যায় বা বাংলায় বলতে হচ্ছে তো এটা ফ্রয়েড নিয়ে আমি প্রস্তুতি ছাড়া বাংলায় বলতে যাওয়াটা একটু মুশকিল তো আমি প্রস্তুত নই আমি ইংরেজিতেই আমার যেটা বলার সেটা বলবো কিন্তু কারোর যদি কিছু বুঝতে অসুবিধা হয় আমার মনে হয় হবে না আমার খুব সহজ ইংরেজি সবাই বুঝতে পারবেন যদি কারো কোনো অসুবিধা হয় আমাকে বলবেন আমি সেই জায়গাগুলো বাংলা করে দেবো আমি পরে বাংলায় বুঝিয়ে দেবো সো উই আর গোয়িং টু টক অ্যাবাউট ফ্রয়েডস কনসেপ্ট অফ দ্য ডেথ ড্রাইভ ইন ইটস রিলেশন টু মেন্টাল হেলথ উইথ ইলাস্ট্রেশন Now, let me begin by pointing out that the concept of the death drive was introduced to the field of psychoanalysis somewhat belatedly by Freud. Although Freud had discovered psychoanalysis in the last decades of the 19th century, he was not able to identify the death drive before 1919. So the first question we should be asking ourselves before going into the question of the death drive is why did Freud take so long to identify such an important concept of psychoanalysis? Well, the answer is a simple one. Freud took so long to identify the death drive because, according to Freud himself, the death drive is in itself silent and never manifests itself directly in its pure form as the death drive as such. It never expresses itself as the death drive as such in its pure form. It is silent in itself. In course of time, Freud came to realize that the death drive becomes discernible, it becomes knowable only when it gets mixed with its opposite, the life drives or the erotic drives. Freud mentions this in his article on the libido theory, written in 1922 and published in 1923, from where I quote, "The one set of drives which work essentially in silence leads the living creature to death and therefore deserve to be called the death drives. The other set of drives would be those which are better known to us in analysis, the libidinal, sexual, or life drives, which are best comprised under the name of Eros," unquote. This is 1922, the libido theory. Now, owing to its importance, Freud repeats this very point in most of his major writings from 1919 onwards, such as in Group Psychology and the Analysis of the Ego, where he writes, "In a recently published study, I have attempted to connect the polarity of love and hatred with a hypothetical opposition between drives of life and death." Then, in The Ego and the Id, Freud writes, "We are driven to conclude that the death drives are by their nature mute, and that the clamor of life proceeds for the most part from Eros." So death drives are mute in nature, and Eros is clamorous, it is noisy. In Civilization and Its Discontent, Freud once again writes, "The desire for destruction, when it is directed inwards, mostly eludes our perception. Of course, unless it is tinged with erotism." And in An Outline of Psychoanalysis, he writes, "So long as that drive operates internally as a death drive, it remains silent. It only comes to our notice when it is diverted outwards as a drive of destruction." Those are, unquote, unquote, some of the examples of Freud stressing on this very important point as to why he took so long to identify the death drive. And in every case, he said that it's because death drive is in itself silent, and we get to know about it only when it gets mixed or tinged, or only in terms of its connection with the opposite kind of instinct, which is life instinct or Eros. The German terms are Todestrieb and Lebenstrieb. And if you add a E at the end, you have drives in the plural in the German language. Now, let us note in passing that Freud himself never used the expression Thanatos to describe the death drives, though he often used the term Eros alongside the German word Lebenstrieb to describe the life drives. The expression Eros and Thanatos came from Freud's student, Wilhelm Steckel, with whose understanding of psychoanalysis, let us keep in mind, Freud had often strongly disagreed. Freud didn't agree with many things said by Steckel. Freud himself used expressions like Eros and death, or Eros and the death drive, as we shall see. Eros and Thanatos is not an incorrect description. However, it is not Freudian, and therefore it can't be attributed to Freud. Freud first hinted at the death drive in his 1919 essay on the uncanny. But it was from his 1920 book called Beyond the Pleasure Principle onwards, whose first draft was completed in 1919 itself, that Freud started to give the concept its due importance as an unrelenting mental urge that is distinct from, and in fact opposed to, the pleasure principle. Prior to the discovery of the death drive, Freud talked about the reality principle and the pleasure principle. He talks about that in the two formulations on mental functioning. You can look up that essay written in 1911, where he talks about mind in terms of the pleasure principle and the reality principle. There's no mention of the death drive there. That the death drive was a belated discovery of extraordinary importance is evident from the simple fact that, whereas the concept does not figure in Freud's writings prior to 1919 at all, there is hardly any important work of Freud written after 1919 in which it does not find mention. Although Freud was perfectly aware that the concept had failed to impress the psychoanalysts and the general public alike, he insisted on the importance of the concept for both the theory and practice of psychoanalysis from the time of its discovery, 1919, till the end of his life, as we shall see. So what does Freud tell us about the life drives, the death drives, and their opposition? Let us glance through some of the important works in chronological order, and I'll be very brief and to the point. In his 1920 Beyond the Pleasure Principle, Freud mentions that the opposition between life drives and death drives come into play from the very beginning of life. I quote him, "Our speculations have suggested that Eros operates from the beginning of life and appears as a life drive in opposition to the death drive, which was brought into being by the coming to life of inorganic substance. These speculations seek to solve the riddle of life by supposing that these two drives were struggling with each other from the very first," unquote. Towards the end of his paper called Negation, written in 1925, Freud equates Eros with affirmation and the death drive or the destructive drive with negation. I quote the operative sentence: affirmation as a substitute for uniting belongs to Eros. Negation, the successor to expulsion, belongs to the drive of destruction. In his 1930 Civilization and Its Discontents, Freud describes the struggle between Eros and death as the essence of life and as the basis of the evolution of human civilization itself. So, you know, it's beyond the point, it's futile to talk about getting rid of the death drive. It is very disturbing, but we have to understand how deeply it is ingrained and what a crucial part it plays in the larger evolution of things. It is not a simple thing that you can, it's not a simple symptom that you can dislodge. This is what Freud writes in Civilization and Its Discontents. It's a very significant citation. I quote him, "Civilization is a process in the service of Eros, whose purpose is to combine single human individuals, and after that families, then races, peoples, and nations into one great unity." So the function of Eros is to unify, the unity of mankind. But man's natural aggressive drive, the hostility of each against all and of all against each, opposes this program of civilization. This aggressive drive is the derivative and the main representative of the death drive, which we have found alongside of Eros and which shares world dominion with it. And now I think the meaning of the evolution of civilization is no longer obscure to us. It must present the struggle between Eros and death, between the drive of life and the drive of destruction, as it works itself out in the human species. This struggle is what all life essentially consists of. And the evolution of civilization may therefore be simply described as the struggle for life of the human species," unquote. And then in the 1940, that is to say posthumous, because Freud died in 39, posthumously published volume called An outline of psychoanalysis, Freud states that whereas the aim of the life drives is to unify and preserve, the aim of the death drives is to disunify, destroy, and ultimately lead the living being into an inorganic state. So the next question I think we should logically ask is, how did Freud come to know of the existence of the death drive? What does Freud say about that? Well, he has generally told us that there is no way of knowing about the death drive separately, because in itself it is silent. It doesn't have any expression by itself. So it becomes, it gets expressed, it becomes manifest only when it gets mixed with its opposite. But did Freud find out the death drive in conjunction with the lifeist instincts? And is that how Freud found it out? Well, that is, the answer is no. Freud says that the death drive became discernible to him. He came to know about it thanks to its chief characteristic, namely death drive's characteristic of repetition compulsion, or compulsion to repeat, or compulsive repetition, as Freud himself mentions in Beyond the Pleasure Principle, when he states that it is, and I quote him, the characteristic of a compulsion to repeat which first put us on the track of the death drive, unquote. So that is how he came to know about it, although it gets knowable when it gets mixed with Eros. Freud was compelled to look for possible forces independent of, or indifferent to, or situated beyond the pleasure principle. I mean, we should be asking, why did Freud go beyond the pleasure principle? Wasn't pleasure principle enough? I mean, it was enough until 1919. So what necessitated Freud looking for the, for what lay beyond the pleasure principle? Why did he at all bother to go beyond? Well, the answer is, he was compelled to look for forces, possible forces lying beyond the pleasure principle, when he came across instances of psychopathology or instances of symptoms in his practice that could not be accounted for in any meaningful way in terms of the pleasure principle. When the pleasure principle and reality principle completely failed to explain certain psychopathological conditions, Freud was compelled to look beyond the pleasure principle for answers to those problems, especially the self-harming tendency of some of his patients, who would endlessly repeat something that is distressful to them. So they would repeat something that is essentially distressful to them without ever noticing the element of repetition underlying their actions. Those who suffer from repetition compulsion tend to justify their acts in terms of the circumstances around the acts, or in terms of the immediate causes motivating the acts, instead of recognizing the more important thing, instead of recognizing any pattern of repetition among a set of similar acts carried out by them over a period of time. So they keep these acts separate and refuse to, and therefore fail to see any connection, and therefore fail to see it as repetition, although they keep on repeating this distressful thing on themselves without any end. Freud clarifies in Beyond the Pleasure Principle that repetition compulsion recalls past experiences that could not have been pleasurable at any point in time. That is to say, they did not become unpleasurable in course of time. They were unpleasurable right from the start and simply continued to be so. In the same work, Beyond the Pleasure Principle, Freud also mentions the conservatism, or the tenacity of the drive. Now, this is the most important thing for mental health workers. You should understand the power of the opponent you are dealing with here. And therefore, you should you shouldn't expect quick and easy success or effect if you are dealing with the death drive. Freud calls it conservatism. What he means is tenacity of the drive. He states that despite repeatedly proving to be the source of unpleasure, repetition, compulsion, and the death drive can be extremely tenacious. I quote Freud, but no lesson has been learned from the old experience of these activities having led only to unpleasure. In spite of that, they are repeated under pressure of a compulsion, quote unquote. Freud repeats this point once again in his 1932 correspondence with Albert Einstein called Why War, which was published in 1933, wherein Freud writes, and I quote, there is no use in trying to get rid of men's aggressive inclinations, unquote. In Beyond the Pleasure Principle, Freud further states that repetition compulsion manifests itself not only in the neurosis, especially in traumatic neurosis, fate neurosis, the melancholic masochistic superego, masochism, sadism, and negative therapeutic reaction. All of these psychopathological conditions have a relation to the death drive. Freud says that repetition compulsion not only manifests itself in these forms of neurosis, but also manifests itself in the normative people, especially in terms of A, we are talking about normative, or as is mistakenly called, normal people, ordinary people, let us say. Repetition compulsion is manifest in everyday life, in ordinary people, in terms of A, their acts that resemble what is called fate neurosis, F-A-T-E, fate neurosis. B, certain games played by very young children. And C, the destructive drive of the ego of individuals or of the ego of nations. The one element in common to all such expressions of the death drive through repetition compulsion, be it neurotic or normative, is the repeated invitation of suffering, or the repeated staging of anguish or destruction by an individual, which explains why the compulsion is at once repetitive and related to the death drive or destructive drive, also known as the ego drive in certain cases. Now, how does Freud explain these expressions of death drive through repetition compulsion in his writings? Let us glance through them, and once again, I'll go straight to the point and draw your attention to what is absolutely crucial without wasting any time. First, traumatic neurosis. Traumatic neurosis usually occurs after severe mechanical concussions, excessive fright, or serious somatic shocks caused by accidents involving a risk to life, such as railway disasters, burials under the earth in an earthquake situation, for example, war, 9/11, and so on. Freud rightly states that traumatic neurosis is a long-known condition. He adds that the dreams occurring in traumatic neurosis, and I quote Freud from Beyond the Pleasure Principle, have the characteristic of repeatedly bringing the patient back into the situation of his accident, a situation from which he wakes up in another fright. So it's kind of repeating the original traumatic situation in the dreams, and the patient gets no respite. মানে জীবনে একবার সাফার করেছে কিন্তু সেটা বারেবারে তার ড্রিমে ফেরত আসছে, একবার সাফার করার মধ্যে দিয়ে তার কষ্টটা শেষ হচ্ছে না. Now such repetitive dreams made Freud classify traumatic neurosis as an expression of the death drive. Now I don't entirely agree with Freud on this because of a Freudian reason, because in so far as traumatic neurosis is a form of binding, B-I-N-D-I-N-G. It represents, and binding is a Freudian word. Freud's German term is Bindung, B-I-N-D-U-N-G. So insofar as traumatic neurosis is a form of binding, it represents the life drive rather than the death drive. Now this is Freud's explanation, not mine. Freud himself states that such repetitive traumatic dreams constitute a form of bindung or binding, which essentially belongs to the pleasure principle. Why? Because it seeks to bound or contain the excitation caused by the trauma. So these repetitive dreams are, if you like, a way of coming to terms with the trauma, and therefore it's a service of the pleasure principle. That is what Freud said. Now, in other words, the repeated staging of the trauma through recurrent dreams of the traumatic situation by the patients, which is suggestive of their fixation to the trauma, is really an attempt by the tendency of binding to come to grips with the trauma by bounding it or containing it through repetition, which is somewhat like how children bound their sense of loss in reality through the games that they play, as we shall see. Freud consistently aligns binding to the pleasure principle and unbinding, the German term is Entbindung, to the death drive. Thus, although Freud classifies traumatic neurosis as an expression of the death drive, it can be easily argued, using Freud's own argument, that the recurrence of traumatic dreams in traumatic neurosis, insofar as it is a form of expression of binding, is in fact the function of the pleasure principle rather than of the death drive. Speaking on the fate neurosis, Freud says that those suffering from fate neurosis are not very different from the normative people whose human relationships always tend to have the same outcome at the end. Freud here says that this is the same as fate neurosis and ordinary people, everyday life situations suffering from some kind of what they consider fate, are of the same category. So what is common amongst those people? The common thing is that their human relationships always tend to have the same outcome at the end. Freud gives a number of examples, and I quote from Beyond the Pleasure Principle, such as the benefactor who is abandoned in anger after a time by each of his proteges, however much they may otherwise differ from one another, and who thus seems doomed to taste all the bitterness of ingratitude. Arthat ekjon gurudev jar aker por ek shishyo take betray korche, or the man whose friendships all end in betrayal by his friend, or the man who time after time in the course of his life raises someone else into a position of great private or public authority, and then after a certain interval himself upsets that authority and replaces him by a new one. Mane kauke ekta tole public life e ba private life e tarpe take shoriye diye arekjon ke tole. The lover, arekta example, each of whose love affairs with a woman passes through the same phases and reaches the same conclusion. This perpetual recurrence of the same thing causes us no astonishment, unquote. Freud sheshe bolchen eta amra obak hocchi na, ei repetition. So ei fake neurosis hocche ei dhoroner repetition, seta everyday life situation e hok, normative people er hok, or neurotic people er hok, tar expression more or less eki rokom hoy. Freud states that both normative people and the neurotic give the impression of being pursued by a malignant fate or possessed by some demonic power. And Freud then continues, but psychoanalysis has always taken the view that their fate is for the most part arranged by themselves and determined by early infantile influences, quote unquote. Freud uses the term fate compulsion. It's a very special expression he uses, fate compulsion, to describe this. Now, I have understood from treating patients of fate neurosis myself that although they invariably complain against fate and attribute all mishaps or failures to their fate or to some divine or cosmic ill will, the truth, in my opinion, is that in quite an ironic way, they never allow, quite an ironic way, they never ever allow fate to play any part in their lives at all. The fate neurotic strongly insulate themselves from any possible influence of fate on their lives by always ultimately transforming whatever fate might offer to them, good, bad, or ugly, into material for repetition compulsion. Folklore captured this irony beautifully. This is an example from folklore. Folklore captured this irony beautifully through the story of the poor, scarcely clothed, homeless, starving, destitute, who sat by the sea, looking at the setting sun, bitterly complaining against and cursing his luck, all the while unmindfully chucking into the sea one pebble after another from a small heap of them that happened to lay next to his hand where he sat down without looking, not realizing that those were pearls, not pebbles. The fate neurotics have the extraordinary ability to latch on to any contingent factor of everyday life and to deftly convert it into the basis of repetition. So it doesn't matter what fate gives them, they'll use it to repeat their same story. So in my opinion, fate neurotics do not allow fate any role to play in their lives, because if they did, then their repetition would be broken and probably they would change. If you like, they convert pearls to pebbles and pebbles to nothing. Psychoanalysis seeks to help them break free from such compulsive cycles with the help of analysis and interpretation. Freud makes an extremely important clarification on the death drive in the context of his discussions on masochism and sadism, where he states that the death drive is first of all directed inwards as a self-destructive impulse in the form of an unconscious, erogenous, primary masochism that becomes evident from a very early stage of life and in which one can see the purest expression of death drive. But much of it is subsequently turned outwards, so first inwards and then outwards, and it turns outwards in a conscious way. Everything becomes the opposite. In a conscious way towards the external world, in the form of the aggressive drive of the ego, evident in sadism and in the ego's will to power and control over others, called the destructive drive of the ego, or the ego drive by Freud. Freud discusses this in his 1924 essay, for those of you who are interested in going through the details. Please look up the 1924 essay of Freud's called The Economic Problem of Masochism. Freud further clarifies in his 1923 The Ego and the Id that the death drive governs the superego in melancholia so strongly that the ego can even be impelled towards death by it if it does not try to fend it off. Now, what does that mean? Simply put, the superego of the melancholics can make the melancholic suffer from guilt, inadequacy, wrongdoing, etc. in such an extreme form. The superego can make the melancholic suffer in such an extreme form that the ego may opt for the route of self-destruction in order to escape the tyranny of the superego, where death becomes the solution, if you like. The death drive also motivates what Freud calls negative therapeutic reaction. And this is extremely tricky and extremely interesting. If you don't understand it, you often tend to confuse it with resistance. It isn't resistance. Negative therapeutic reaction is something in terms of which the analysts protect their symptoms and thus refuse to be cured of their suffering, in spite of making strong demands of the psychoanalyst to the contrary, like asking the doctor to cure him, but trying his or her best to keep the symptoms protected and not be cured, or they paradoxically fall more seriously ill following a series of correct interpretations. Freud thinks that this phenomenon too derives from unconscious feelings of guilt or primary masochism, and as such it is linked to the death drive. This is how Freud explains it in The Ego and the Id, but he talks about it in many other places as well. I quote him, "There are certain people who behave in a quite peculiar fashion during the work of analysis. When one speaks hopefully to them or express satisfaction with the progress of the treatment, they show signs of discontent and their condition invariably becomes worse. One begins by regarding this as a defiance and as an attempt to prove their superiority to the physician. But later one comes to take a deeper and juster view. One becomes convinced not only that such people cannot endure any praise or appreciation, but that they react inversely to the progress of the treatment. Every partial solution that ought to result and in other people does result in an improvement or a temporary suspension of symptoms produces in them for the time being an exacerbation, that is to say an increase of their illness. So upokar holei oshukta bere jay. They get worse during the treatment instead of getting better. They exhibit what is known as a negative therapeutic reaction. There is no doubt that there is something in these people that sets itself against their recovery. We are accustomed to say that the need for illness has got the upper hand in them over the desire for recovery. In the end, we come to see that we are dealing with what may be called a moral factor, a sense of guilt, which is finding its satisfaction in the illness and refuses to give up the punishment of suffering." Unquote. Freud thinks that the unconscious feeling of guilt finds its satisfaction from the patient's falling ill and receiving punishment from suffering. This unconscious feeling of guilt is difficult to identify because the patient falls ill instead of feeling guilty. And it is difficult to treat because it takes an extremely obstinate form of resistance to analysis. It proves the conservatism or the tenacity of the drive that I mentioned a few minutes back. Let me give you an example. One of the best that I found in the field of psychoanalysis, fortunately, it's of one of my own patients. One of my own patients once offered me a remarkable example of unconscious negative therapeutic reaction in course of a treatment. While I have witnessed negative therapeutic reactions several times in my practice, this particular instance was remarkable for the sustained and clearly unconscious nature of the reaction. It was sustained and unconscious. To cut a long story short, a few months into her analysis, this analyst reported in one of her weekly sessions that an interpretation offered by me in the previous session had had a telling effect on one of her old, persistent and major symptoms, leaving her symptom drastically modified at the end. So it was a kind of a cure of a long-lasting problem, or partial cure. After describing the effects of the interpretation on her symptom in detail, she further informed me that the day after the previous session, she lost her appointment diary, in which she noted down the dates and times of all her appointments, including those with me. And that 3 days later, she lost her cell phone, possibly in the supermarket, but she wasn't sure, in which she had my phone number. She added that since her session always took place on the same day of the week and at the same time, she had no difficulty in arriving at the right time for her session despite these losses. She said on the same session, she understood that this was a trick, her word, this was a trick of her mind, and that she would try her best to not miss any session because she must not succumb to this. She saw it as a general unconscious impulse. That is how she saw it. She thought it was a general unconscious impulse that was working against her interest. That was her interpretation. She did not view it as negative therapeutic reaction. And I didn't explain the theory to her because that wasn't necessary. Now, in spite of her strong intent, she failed to turn up in the next two consecutive sessions after that, which is something she had never done before. She never missed two sessions in a row before, ever before. She later on attributed her absence to two mistakes unconsciously made by her on her way to my clinic on the 2 days concerned. On the first day, she had to get off the bus midway because she realized while trying to buy her ticket that she was not carrying her purse in which she had her money and all her cards. And on the second day, traveling with two purses on her, she unmindfully crossed the road. Amazing. She crossed the road, took a bus going in the opposite direction, and realized her mistake while trying to buy her ticket much later. And she said the bus stop she wanted to get down to that conductor when the conductor told her that the bus was headed towards Diamond Harbor. Beyond which, let us note, there was nowhere for her to go. Finally, in Beyond the Pleasure Principle, Freud describes the game. He gives an example from his personal life in Beyond the Pleasure Principle. Freud describes the game invented and played by the 1.5-year-old Ernst Wolfgang, the son of Freud's second daughter, Sophie, who would go on to become a psychoanalyst himself, Ernst Wolfgang. The game that he played when he was 1.5 years old with a reel and a piece of thread attached to it. The little boy played with it by swinging it under and out of his bed and uttering the sounds oo, O-O-O, and ah, A-A-A, respectively, while the reel swung below the cot or the bed, he said oo. When the reel swung out of the cot, he said, ah, while he did this swinging business, in which Freud heard the German word fort and da. U and ah, Freud says, is fort, F-O-R-T. So the O is there, and da, which in German means gone and here, or gone and returned, or not there and present. Nei, achi. Freud interpreted this self-invented game of the little boy as his way of representing his mother's departure and return so as to be able to come to terms with her painful disappearance and absence that he could neither prevent nor control, but strongly dislike. This is quite normative because when babies are given injections, for example, they cope with a part of the suffering thereby caused to their egos. Their egos are hurt as much as their bodies. They cope with a part of the suffering caused to their egos by playing at giving injections to their toys or siblings or playmates when they return home. Freud writes in Beyond the Pleasure Principle, children repeat everything that has made a great impression on them in real life, and that in doing so, they abreact the strength of the impression and, as one might put it, make themselves master of the situation, unquote. In the example of Freud's grandson, the mother's absence is the distressful act of the mother that the boy constantly repeated or repeated untiringly. This is how Freud explains the repetition. This is an instance of the compulsion to repeat what is distressful manifesting itself in a child's game, because the boy repeated only the gone part of the game. He only represented the departure of the mother as a game in itself far more frequently than the game in its entirety with its pleasurable ending. So although the game in its totality and a sad part and a happy ending to it, this boy actually repeated only the sad part more often. So it's a case of repetition compulsion and death drive or distressful repetition in expressed in terms of games of children, and in this case a game of a child of 1.5. Although Freud does not directly make this point, the boy's act is both sadistic and masochistic. The boy's act is sadistic because he rejects the abandoning mother by defiantly throwing away her toy replica himself. So this toy represents the mother, and the boy is actually throwing away the toy. He rejects this toy replica himself as if to say, all right then, go away. I don't need you. I am sending you away myself. This is how Freud interprets it. And the boy is masochistic because he untiringly repeats and thus endlessly suffers from the painful truth of his mother's withdrawal, exit, and absence. The boy's sadism is also evident from the fact that 1 year later, that is to say when he was 2.5, whenever he was angry with a toy, he would throw it on the floor and exclaim, "Go to the font," which he did because he had learned that his father, who was a soldier, was at the front. And rather than regret his absence, the boy was enjoying his sole possession of his mother, says Freud. And the boy's sadism and masochism in general are evident from the details provided by Freud that when his mother died, was really gone. Ooh, the boy was 5 3/4 at that time. Freud writes, the boy showed no sign of grief, quote unquote. However, as already indicated, like in traumatic neurosis, the repetition of something distressful in children's games too can be seen as an attempt at binding and as such as an expression of the life drive rather than of the death drive. While Freud thus attributes traumatic neurosis, fate neurosis, the melancholic masochistic superego, masochism, sadism, negative therapeutic reaction, children's games, and the destructive drive of individuals and nations to the complementary concepts of death drive and repetition compulsion, what does he attribute the death drive and repetition compulsion to? Freud explains both death drive and the compulsion to repeat as the biological urge of the living organism to return to an earlier inorganic state. Thus, Freud explains repetition compulsion in Beyond the Pleasure Principle as, and I quote him, an urge inherent in organic life to restore an earlier state of things. So it's the, unquote. So it's the urge of life itself to return to an inorganic state or the state of death that precedes the state of life, which is the original inorganic condition of life. Freud adds that, and I quote, all living substance is bound to die from internal causes, unquote. Now, Freud writes that he felt compelled to say that, I quote him again, the aim of all life is death, and looking backwards, that inanimate things existed before living ones, quote unquote. Now, what does that mean? Simply put, in other words, the compulsion to repeat strives towards the complete reduction of excitation by trying to lead the living organism back to its original inorganic state of rest once again. Similarly, Freud explains death drive in his An Outline of Psychoanalysis as follows. If we assume that living things came later than inanimate ones and rose from them, then the death drive fits in with the formula we have proposed to the effect that drives tend towards a return to an earlier state, unquote. So following the logic of the pleasure principle, energy must be conserved at all costs. But following the logic of the death drive, energy must be reduced to nothing, reduced to an original state of rest, or return to its original inorganic condition. This is the paradox that characterizes human behavior in general, according to Freud. Now, if living things came after or arose from inanimate things, and the aim of all life is death, because all life finally ends in death, and all life emerges from a state of non-life, then death seems to be both the aim and origin of life, making life itself a detour from death that always ultimately returns to death. So this life then becomes a kind of an unnatural condition, but an exceptional condition for the living organism, because its natural state, according to Freud, is this state of rest, to which it will invariably return. So to sum it up, the death drive is silent, inexorable. It's a silent, inexorable impulse towards an original inorganic state whose presence becomes apparent only in its opposition to the life drives in the form of a powerful urge to overwhelm, dissolve, unbind, or destroy, and in terms of its characteristic of compulsive repetition. Death drive is first directed inwards in the form of an unconscious primary masochism, from where it is directed outwards in the form of conscious sadism or destructivity of the ego. It is as much evident in normative people as in the neurotic. To illustrate the Freudian concepts of death drive and repetition compulsion with the assistance of a widely known work of Indian literature, Bangla literature to be precise, one can turn to the instance of the young girl named Roton in Rabindranath Tagore's short story, The Postmaster. This young adolescent, who is an orphan and had thus already experienced the shock of the loss of dear ones, either in reality or as a report, experiences a semblance of this shock of loss of dear ones once again when the postmaster, whose maid, cook, and nurse she was, finds the idea of taking her with him to Kolkata unthinkable when he wanted to return there for good after recovering from a bout of illness. As many of you would remember, when Roton wants to go with him to Kolkata and says, "Will you take me along?" he says, "Sheki kore hobe." But Roton's sense of that's the point where she gets a shock of this loss, a loss that she has already experienced as an orphan. But Roton's sense of loss is acutely aggravated when the postmaster is really gone, Fort, German Fort, gone, Freud's grandson. Following the postmaster's parting, Roton in a way enacts repetition compulsion by going round and round the empty post office building in which he used to live with him. I quote Amit Choudhury's translation of the crucial passage from the short story. She, that is Roton, weeping unstoppably, was only wondering again and again about the building of the post office. Perhaps there was a tenuous hope in her heart to do with Dada Babu coming back. Trapped, she found herself unable to go far from where she was roaming, unquote. Now, finally, the narrator exclaims, "Alas, the forever deluded human heart." The human heart is deluded, according to the narrator in this story, because it embraces false hopes tightly to the breast, and although it has its blood sucked out and its very connection with life destroyed by this mistake at the time of disillusionment, that inevitably sets in at the end. Disillusionment inevitably comes at the end, and when that comes, its life is destroyed by the realization. It recovers from its misery and returns to its right senses only to crave to fall into the grip of a new destructive delusion. I quote once again from Amit Choudhury's translation, "Alas, the mistaken human heart, its delusions never end. The laws of reason enter the mind after much delay, disbelieving incontestable evidence, it embraces false hope with both arms and all its might to its breast. In the end, one day, severing the umbilical cord and sucking the heart empty of blood, it flees. There is then a return to one's right senses, and the mind grows restless again to embrace its next delusion." I'll share with you how Rabindranath puts it in Bangla. Hai buddhihin manobridoy bhranti kichutei ghochena jukti shastrer bidhan bohu bilombe mathay probesh kore probol pramankeo obishwas koriya mithya ashake dui bahupashe bandhiya buker bhitore pranpone joraiya dhora jay obosheshe ekdin somosto nari katiya hridoyer rokto shushiya she polayon kore tokhon chetona hoy ebong দ্বিতীয়বার ভ্রান্তি পাশে পড়িবার জন্য চিত্ত ব্যাকুল হইয়া উঠে। The death drive turned out to be one of the most controversial concepts of Freud because it generated huge resistances within the psychoanalytical community and was rejected by a large number of his disciples, including by Girindra Shekhar Bose. If you want these details, I'll be happy to share them with you. But I'm sure we have run out of time, so I'll leave them for your questions. Towards the end of his life, in his 1937 analysis, Terminable and Interminable, Freud states that he was well aware that his theory found little acceptance even among the psychoanalysts. Nevertheless, he continued to insist on the importance of the concept for the rest of his life. In fact, despite the huge controversy generated by the concept of the death drive and repetition compulsion within the psychoanalytic community, Freud himself adhered to it more and more strongly as time went by. In Civilization and Its Discontent, Freud admits that the concept was advanced tentatively, but he stresses that it gradually imposed itself upon him. I quote Freud, "To begin with, it was only tentatively that I put forward the views I have developed here. But in the course of time, they have gained such a hold upon me that I can no longer think in any other way," unquote. In a postscript that he added in 1935 to an autobiographical study, this book called An Autobiographical Study of 1935, there's a postscript that Freud added where he even regards the death drive as one of his last two decisive contributions to psychoanalysis. The other one being the discovery of the id, ego and superego. To conclude, it is remarkable that the discoverer of the death drive, Sigmund Freud, consciously chose the route of euthanasia to end his own life. Dr. Max Schur, S-C-H-U-R, was a young medical intern who was introduced to Freud by Marie Bonaparte and who went on to become Freud's physician in 1929, treating Freud and the members of his family until Freud's death in 1939, last 10 years. When Freud interviewed Schur before appointing him as his physician, Freud asked for two promises, categorically, that he would always be told the truth and nothing but the truth about the state of his health. Now, for those of you who are not aware, Freud was suffering from cancer, oral cancer, jawbone cancer, from the age of 60 roundabout, and he went on to live till he was 80. So for the last 20 years of his life, he was battling extraordinary pain. There was an operation theater in his house itself because his jawbone had to be operated upon so frequently. Anyway, I mean, you can read up a very beautiful account by Suniti Kumar Chatterjee, his meeting with Freud in 1935, where he talks about Freud's state in great detail, and you have it in Bangla and in English. Suniti Chatterjee himself wrote it in both languages. He translated himself. So you can read that up. So he said two things, that he would always be told the truth and nothing but the truth about his state of health, and that he would not be required to suffer unnecessarily when the time arrived. And the time arrived meaning when Freud would say the time is arrived. Both of which were readily granted by Max Schur. Schur ends his Freud biography, which I'll urge those of you who are interested in this chapter to read. This doctor wrote a biography of Freud called Freud Living and Dying, in which Schur also offers his precious opinion on Freud's ideas about death and the death drive. With a precise, now Schur ends his Freud biography with a precise description of how he fulfilled his second promise to Freud by medically assisting his death. And this is the crucial passage with which I'll end. I quote Max Schur, on September 21st, while I was sitting at the bedside, Freud took my hands and said to me, "My dear Schur, you certainly remember our first talk. You promised me then not to forsake me when my time comes. Now it's nothing but torture and makes no sense anymore." I indicated, so this is Schur then writing, I indicated that I had not forgotten my promise. He sighed with relief, held my hand for a moment longer and said, "I thank you." And Freud is doing that because he had a bad experience with his previous doctor who was sacked in 1929 because he had given false information to Freud about the state of his health. So Freud was slightly wary. He was not absolutely sure that he would be told the truth. So when he heard the truth, there was a sigh of relief and he thanks Max Schur and he says, "I thank you." And after a moment of hesitation, he added, "Tell Anna about this." All this was said without a trace of emotionality or self-pity and with full consciousness of reality. I informed Anna of our conversation as Freud had asked. When he was again in agony, I gave him a hypodermic of 2 centigrams of morphine. Now in those days, some of the European doctors...
Excuse me, Professor Vishash. এক সেকেন্ড ইন্টারাপ্ট করব বলছি আপনার অডিওটা ইউটিউব লাইভে শোনা যাচ্ছে না হয়তো আপনার ওই ব্লুটুথ স্পিকারটার চার্জ কমে গেছে ওটাকে কি কোনোভাবে পাওয়ার কানেক্ট করা যায় অথবা ওটা ছাড়া বলা যায় কারণ ইউটিউব লাইভের কেউ শুনতে পাচ্ছে না ভালো করে ওইটার খুব স্ট্রেংথটা লো হয়ে গেছে ব্লুটুথের আমরা গুগল মিটে শুনতে পাচ্ছি আপনাকে পরিষ্কার এখন আপনাকে শুনতেই পাচ্ছি না ওই ব্লুটুথের ডঙ্গলটা বোধহয় আপনাকে ডিটাচ করতে হবে তা না হলে ও সাউন্ডটাকে ব্লুটুথে রাখ করছে
এখন তো স্যার মিউট আছেন
ও আচ্ছা সরি 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 আপনি মিউট আছেন বলে শুনতে পাচ্ছি না আপনি আনমিউট হলে শুনতে পাবো
এখন কি শোনা যাচ্ছে
ক্লিয়ার ক্লিয়ার স্যার একদম পরিষ্কার শোনা যাচ্ছে
আর কত কখন থেকে শুনতে পারেনি আমাকে
লাস্ট ধরুন আমি ইউটিউবে পাচ্ছি লাস্ট মিনিট দশেক ধরে শুনতে পাচ্ছেন আর
তাহলে ওই জায়গা থেকে সেটা তো আমার আমার তো ওইভাবে হিসেব নেই আমার তো আংশ শেষ হয়ে গেছে আমার বলা প্রায় তো আমি কি করব আমি আমার লাস্ট সাইটেশনটা শেষ করে নি তারপরে আপনাদের যদি প্রশ্ন থাকে কোন পয়েন্ট থেকে শুনেন নি আমি না আরেকবার এক্সপ্লেইন করে দেব
হ্যাঁ সেটাই ভালো
হবে আমার পড়া বাকি সেই পয়েন্টে
আসলে আমিও বলতে পারবো না কারণ আমি গুগল মিটে শুনতে পাচ্ছি বলে যারা শুনতে পাচ্ছে না তারাই শুধু বলতে পারবে ওটা আমরা কোশ্চেন অ্যান্সার সেশনটাতে ঢুকলে তারপরে ডিসকাস করে নেব আমার
আমার জাস্ট এই ম্যাক্স শুয়ারের বায়োগ্রাফি লাস্ট পার্টটা
হ্যাঁ
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ এটা খুব ইন্টারেস্টিং লাগে আই গেভ হিম আ হাইপোডার্মিক অফ 2 সেন্টিগ্রামস অফ মরফিন নাও আই ওয়াজ এক্সপ্লেইনিং দ্যাট দিস মে সাউন্ড অড সেন্টিগ্রামস অফ মরফিন But in certain American, certain European medical systems, especially West European, in those days, this is like early 20th century, they used to still follow the 19th century convention and often describe morphine doses and other doses in centigrams. So I gave him a hypodermic of 2 centigrams of morphine. He soon felt relief and fell into a peaceful sleep. The expression of pain and suffering was gone. I repeated this dose after about 12 hours. Freud was obviously so close to the end of his reserves that he lapsed into a coma and did not wake up again. He died at 3 a.m. on September 23rd, 1939. Unquote and concluded. Thank you very much.
হ্যাঁ শান্তনুদা, থ্যাংক ইউ, থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ শান্তনু, প্রফেসর শান্তনু বিশ্বাস ফর হিজ লুমিনাস প্রেজেন্টেশন।